विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति।
उवाच शङ्करपादपजाभीष्टम् अश्रुपूर्णाकुलेक्षणम् विशीदन्तमिदम् वाक्यम् उवाच मधुसूदनः श्रीभगवानुवाच उतत्पाकष्णदमिदम् विषमेतमुपस्थितम् अनाद्यजुष्टमस्पर्श्यम् अशीर्णिकरमर्जुन क्लैव्यमात्मकमपाथ नैतत्त्वयुपपद्यते शुद्रम् हृदय दौर्बल्यम् यत्कोऽतिष्ठ परम् तप। अर्जुन उवाच कथम् भीष्ममहम् सङ्ख्ये द्रोणम् च मधुसूदन विशुभि प्रतियोच्यामि पूजाथा परिसूदन गुरो न हत्वादि महानुभावान् श्रेयो भोक्तुम् वैक्ष्यमपि लोके हत्वार्थकामांसु गुरुनिहैव भुञ्जीय भोगान् दुरिरप्रदिग्धान् न चैतद्विस्मः कतरन्नो गरीयः यद्वा जयेम यदि वा नो जयेयुः याने वहत्वा न जिजीविषामः देवस्थिता प्रमुखे धातराष्ट्राः पार्पण्यदोषोपहतः स्वभावः पृच्छामि त्वाम् धर्मसम्मूलचेताः यच्छ्रेयस्यानिश्चितम् ब्रूहि तन्मे शिष्यस्तेऽहम् शास्त्रिमाम् त्वाम् प्रपन्नम् न हि प्रपश्यामि ममापनुद्यात् यच्छोकमुच्छोषणमिन्द्रियाणाम् अवाप्य भूमावत पत्नवृद्धम् राज्यम् सुराणामपि चाधिपत्यम्। सञ्जय उवाच एवमुक्त्वा ऋषिकेशम् पुराकेशत्परम् तप नयोद्यजिति गोविन्दम् उक्त्वा तुष्टीम् बभूवः तमुवाच ऋषिकेशः प्रहसन्निव भारत तेन योरुभयो मध्ये ऋषीदम् समिदम् वचः।
The question that is posed by Arjuna, picking up an action and asking the question, is this not wrong action? Is this not a criminal action? Is this not something that we should not be doing? So, how can you ask me to do this action? Again, starting point of it is the understanding. In relation to action. How many ever times we hear, how many ever times we discuss, we study, we still go by actions. You assess yourself through your actions, you assess others through the actions. Number one, you assess yourself through your actions. Not only you assess yourself through your actions, you assess others also through their actions. And yet, the first lesson that he is saying is, actions per se has no meaning. You cannot assess, you cannot understand anything through the action. To understand the action, you need to go to the origin of the action, not the action per se. Since we have no other way to relate to another except through action, like a simple example, you can assess only when the person starts doing something, some kind of action, maybe a physical action, or he has to speak, or he has to say something. First understand, there are three types of action: thought, word and deed. Thoughts you have no access to, you can only understand through the word and the deed, which is the external or the grossification of a thought. So you can assess only through the deed, through the thought. Both are unrelated, because as he says in the words of Shakespeare, one may smile and smile and smile and yet be a villain, because these two are unreliable. And yet we completely rely on action and the words to process. So when he talks about action, first things you understand is thought, word and deed. Thought you have no access to, because since you have no access to your own innermost thoughts, how can you access others? You cannot, since you assess yourself through your actions. Since you assess yourself through the words that you speak, you assess others also through that, and then come to a conclusion. What is the conclusion? Right, wrong, good, bad. So first thing which Arjuna didn't understand is how to assess and not to conclude. How to assess but not to conclude. We assess only to quickly come to a conclusion, and then we are happy with that conclusion, and we refuse to change. Again I repeat, assessment leads to, we do not know how to assess but not conclude. Assessment part is objectivity, conclusion part is the judgment. Again I repeat, the assessment part of it is objectivity, the conclusion part of it is, but then we do not know the difference between, first of all we don't even realize these two are different. Assessment is meant only for conclusion, no, otherwise why? Correct, huh? Otherwise why assess? Assessment means you have to conclude, sir. Otherwise simply assessing for what? Like a simple example, snake is poisonous is assessment, snake is bad is the judgment that arises out of this assessment. Simple example. Again I repeat, snake is poisonous is assessment, but that doesn't make the snake neither good nor bad. The same snake in a temple becomes holy, the same snake in some other place becomes. So assessment and the conclusion. Conclusion is always based on what? Action. And you conclude based on what? you conclude, you judge based on what? Words and deeds. Because you have no access to thoughts. You have no access to thoughts. Therefore, all conclusions arises out of the words that others speak, the action of the others. Like for example, once in a week, for 1 hour, you access me. Once in a week, that too for 1 hour. And that 1 hour is the best friend I can put. So all your assessment or all your judgment, all your conclusions arises out of what? Based on this 1 hour. Supposing if you have access to me somewhere else, in some other place, where my actions and words are different, the conclusion would be different. In both the cases, what you don't have access to? Thoughts. You don't have access to thoughts. Based on the action and the word, you conclude about what? Oh, that's what you would have meant. Or maybe that's what he is. Using the gross, you assess the subtle. Fundamental flaw. Using the gross, you assess the subtle. What is subtle? The innermost thoughts, the intentions are subtle. And what is gross? Words and deeds are gross. So you use the words and deeds in order to assess the subtle. Every relationship turns into a problem because of this reverse logic. We use the gross to assess the subtle. And yet the truth is, it is the subtle that controls the gross. The gross has no influence over the subtle. How do you say that? One may smile and smile and smile and yet be a villain. Arjuna belongs to this category. Where the vast majority of human beings belongs to. He belongs to the category. Where the vast majority belongs to. What is the category? Assessment through actions, assessment through words. A person uses the word, by that word you say, oh, this is what you would have meant. Or if you didn't mean it, then why did you use this word? Or the very fact that you have used this word means you meant only. And the other person says, I used this word but I didn't mean this. So that man tries to prove that he didn't mean it. You try to prove that that's what he meant. So you will start forming associations with people who are in agreement with you. So naturally what will happen is, you cannot live with everyone. So you will naturally start forming associations with people who are in agreement with you. Like, even in a classroom where there are 30 children, there will be 5-6 groups, no? All belong to the same classroom, but even then there will be 5-6. And if you see that 5-6, what is it? They will be in, all the 3-4 will be in agreement. What is that agreement? Whatever they agree with. Based on what? The conclusions are arrived through actions. And yet the philosophy says, the starting point of it is, action per se doesn't mean anything. It is that which is driving the action. It is that intention that is driving the action. Based on actions, you cannot assess your Based on actions, you cannot assess yourself, neither you can assess another. But then, you have no other means. Supposing a person comes and just sits quiet, not saying a word. For the first few minutes, you will think, what? the first few minutes you will think maybe he is in deep sorrow, or maybe he is something. 5 minutes, 7 minutes, not speaking anything or not showing any signs of expressions, sitting like Buddha in meditation, what will you do? You have to assess, you have to interact, you have to relate. So what will you say, what will you do? First thing, what will you do? What would you do? Say something. Why are you sitting? Say something. Because when they start saying something, you can start assessing, and then you can start your relations. The person comes and sits quietly, not raise a word. You will not know. You will not know what to do. Because of what? You've been trained to assess through words and actions. That's where you can make some, you can practice action, you can practice words. Again I repeat, you can practice action. Like I have practiced action and coming and sitting here and talking. It's a practice. One is you can practice action. You can practice your words. Another is that which is the core. Which is where I said some time back, understand the difference. The core and the periphery. Using the periphery, do not conclude about the core. Arjuna has concluded. What? The periphery. What is the periphery? Verse number 4. How can I fight with arrows against Bhishma and Drona? Who are they? They are worthy of worship. They are meant to be served, not to fight against. Not only fight against, you have to kill them. How can you do that, Arjuna? How can you do that, Krishna? Because it's a wrong action. It's a wrong action. Comes from this wrong understanding. What? Action means something. Action per se means something right. Action per se means something wrong. Lastly, understand this. How much ever you practice action, how much ever you practice words, your inner nature will start helplessly, he says. Later on, he says, Arjuna, helplessly your inner nature will manifest. Yavashaha, he says. Helplessly it will manifest. And except you, everyone will be. Everyone else will be aware of it. Here he says, you should be aware of it, not others. Now it is the reverse. Everyone else is aware except your own. Therefore, atrocious act of killing one's own guru. He has magnified it to a situation where how can you kill guru? How can you kill the guru as an atrocious action? You will understand the atrocity of that action when will you understand the atrocity behind this action? If you have lived with the master, received his blessings, received his love and compassion, received beneficiary of his service and sacrifice. Since we have no access to all that, Since we don't understand all that, we think, what is atrocity in killing? Killing one's own guru, what is the magnification in that? Whenever you think of guru, you think of your school teacher or college teacher. No, that's the guru that you have. That's the guru. Then you have lived with the guru, received his blessings, the benediction, the love, the compassion, his service, his sacrifice. You owe everything to him. How can you kill? How can you fight against such a person? It's very difficult to understand. It's very difficult to understand the scenario. Why it is so difficult to understand the scenario is because we have not received it. Or when you say we have not received it, it is there, but we have been blocking it. The compassion is there for all and we have been blocking it. So relatively understand it like this. Relatively understand what someone has done some service to you. How can you do something? How can you do something? How can you do something that will destroy you? That's all he is saying. He has done something good to you. How can you do something that will destroy him? Krishna, and you are also supporting this action. All comes from what? Virtuous action can have a vicious intention. Vicious action can have a virtuous intention. That distinction he is not able to understand. A vicious action can have virtuous intention. Seemingly virtuous action can have a vicious intention. That's all. What seems cruel from outside may be done with love and compassion. What looks like love and compassion might be completely indifferent at the core. Again, I repeat. What seems to be a virtuous action of love and sacrifice can stem from the deepest indifference. Or what appears like the cruel, vicious action can come from the deepest love. Only you can know. That's why he says the best judge is your own. Best judge is your own conscience. Because only you can know this. Or someone who is above than you will know. Either you will know it for yourself or someone above you will know. Better is to take the second option. Why not the first? Carefully follow. In my opinion, I'm saying better is to take the second option, not the first. Because today, no one conscience makes you believe that you are doing something fundamentally wrong. No conscience ever says that you are doing something fundamentally wrong. And yet you go to the higher, he always says you are fundamentally wrong. Therefore, between the two only, at your level, you feel that, okay, here and there, some small mistakes here and there I have done, sir. Yeah. Some mistakes I did there, some mistakes I did here, some mistakes I did when I was in school. You talk to anyone, they will never say anything about what they did. Now, they always talk about what, 10 years back what I did, 25 years back in school what I did. That's dead and gone. What are you doing? At your level, in the present, everything looks fine, correct. And yet, the higher always is, you are still fundamentally wrong. Therefore, one way of understanding is through your own conscience. And don't worry about your conscience, because your mind itself sometimes plays like conscience. Your mind itself appears like intellect. sometimes you will never know what is where mind stops and where intellect starts, or where intellect stops and where conscience starts. The distinction is so muddled, it's so mixed up. Therefore, better option, better choice is what? Consult the eye. Which is what Arjuna did. Even though he was very clear, in another two more verses he is going to say, I don't, even though it looks all this Krishna, you please tell me. Even though he seems to know everything, one good thing that Arjuna did is, one good thing that he did is what? After doing all the assessment, he went to him and said, please tell me what I should do. Please tell me what I should do. Exactly the opposite is what? You assess, you come to a conclusion and then say, this is what I have decided to do. Krishna will say, please go ahead and do. I will also, if you need any help, I will support you also. What will be the result? Destruction. Result is destruction. Verse number 5.
Guru Nahatvahi Mahanubhavan Shreyo Bhoktum Parichyamati Valoke Hatvatakamam Suguru Vihaiva Kunjiya Bhogan Rudhira Pradishthan. Guru Nahatvahi Mahanubhavan Shreyo Bhoktum Parichyamati Valoke Hatvatakamam Suguru Vihaiva Kunjiya Bhogan Rudhira Pradishthan.
Better indeed is to live on alms in this world than to slay the most noble teachers. But by slaying them, all my enjoyments of wealth and desires, even here, will be stained with blood. How much ever wise he appears, how much ever noble he speaks, the intentions comes out. That's what. Every 2-3 verses, he speaks about his real intention. What is the real intention? By slaying them, my enjoyments will be guilty. I cannot enjoy. I will have everything, but along with that I have guilt also. Therefore, when Arjuna says, I will not kill my teachers, he is not actually worried about the teachers. What is he actually worried about? His enjoyments will be with? Stained with guilt. So he is asking, is there a method by which I can enjoy, I can do all this and not feel guilty also? That's what actually he is asking. What is he actually asking? I want to enjoy and not feel. How is it possible? First thing he says, I will live on alms. Supreme sacrifice. What? Is to live on alms. That is better, Krishna, than to slay. They are not ordinary teachers. The most noble teachers. Dronacharya, where will you get a man like him? Where will you get a teacher? I can. And where will you get a man like Bhishma to live with? Where will you get a person like Bhishma where you can see that it is actually possible to do all this? Better to live on alms than to kill them. If you had stopped here, Krishna would have said, correct. We both will go. Because how can you kill your own after the after the assessment, the conclusion. All your assessments linked to wrong conclusion. It means your assessment itself is, you can't rightly assess and wrongly conclude. If the conclusions are wrong, it means assessment is also wrong. I assessed correctly, sir, but conclusion only wrong. Yeah. But by slaying them, I will kill them. If I start fighting, I will kill them. But what will happen? Every time I sit to eat, every time I am enjoying something, that guilt will kill me. So even when he talks about protecting dharma, even when he talks about protecting the other, what is he actually concerned about? Who is he actually concerned about? Himself. Himself. See, someone leaves a valuable behind. Someone leaves a valuable behind. So you see it, you rush and give it. And you think you have actually done? And you think you have actually done something? Something good. Someone leaves the wallet behind, or someone leaves a very expensive phone behind. You rush and give it. And you actually think you have done something good. Exactly what Arjuna is doing. Now, understand this. The person takes it from you, doesn't even turn back and acknowledge and say, thank you. You feel? Sad. You feel offended. Avlo kashtapatti, I ran behind the, about to break my legs. I would have been in ICU trying to help. And all that the person was, didn't even turn back and say, thank you. So, when you gave, what are you actually doing? Others must recognize your, others must recognize your good action. Your good intention. Correct. What is that intention? You think it is good intention. What Krishna is saying is, I am not saying this, sir. Shankar. Na solla. Krishna is saying. What Krishna is saying, even your intentions are not good. Why? Because if you have kept that with you, you would have felt, you will feel guilty. So even when you give, you are only avoiding guilt. You are only giving only to avoid. Sir, what should I do, sir? Now, should I give or should I? What do we do? Till now Gita was very easy. Bhagavad Gita was very comfortable. Suddenly Bhagavad Gita looks very, very complicated. And for the last 30 years I have been reading Gita, I have never heard this. Now Krishna is saying, you are only protecting yourself from your guilt. Supposing if you can keep it and not feel guilty at all, what you would have done? Assume this possibility. Supposing you can keep it and you will not feel any sense of remorse, you will not feel any sense of guilt, or if you have been conditioned to believe that this is the right thing to do, what will happen? What will happen? You will not give. In fact, actually what you will start doing? Actually what you will start doing? காதலே வரல எனக்கு எதுவுமே. God has given you. What will you do? Actually, you will start creating situations by which you can take. You will start working on situations. You will start creating situations where you can steal, where you can do, and you will not feel any remorse at all. Yeah. The fellow on the roadside, he's not having any food to eat, struggling, battling to life. 20 rupees you have, that too, Tom? Yeah, one side is Tom, note you have, and the fellow picks it. He gets, what happens to him? He gets caught and he is thrashed, correct? Because of what? He has stolen. Correct? If you beat him for the fact that he has stolen, if stealing is wrong, what should happen? First thing, if stealing is such a bad thing to do, if stealing is such a wrong thing to do, what you should do first? First thing, what should be done? All business schools must be closed down. Correct? All business schools you should strike against and say, close it. Because what is taught there? What is taught? Bharat. How to exploit? How to manipulate? How to steal? How to put 30 conditions in a way that fellow will not understand what he is signing for. Correct? But then, it's done in a suit and a coat, and the man gets on from the BMW car, sitting on the 15th floor doing that, looks, appears. Valmiki told this to Narada. Before he turned Valmiki, he was a highway robber. Yeah, not ordinary. He was a pirate. Highway robber, na? Pirates. Not. They are master class in thieving. Pirates they are. And he is the head of that group. And Narada said, aren't you doing something bad? He said, I am doing my Kula Dharma. Read that portion. He said, I am doing my Kula Dharma. I will not incur any sin because I am doing my Kula Dharma. What is my Kula Dharma? Rob. Little bit you learn here and there, you will stop stealing, robbing, because it has been planted in you so deeply. What? It is? To stealing is wrong, and you feel that you are doing something wrong, and you feel guilty. So when you are not stealing, it's not that you are against stealing. Please understand that. It's a wrong logic to conclude. That's what Krishna is saying. Engita Goskarigo. Krishna is saying it's a wrong logic to conclude as though you are against stealing. It's a wrong logic to conclude, Arjuna, that you are against killing the Guru. What is the real reason? What is the true reason? The true reason, the real reason is your own guilt. Therefore, even when you are serving, it's only to protect. Even when you give, it's only to avoid your guilt. Even when you serve, it's only to avoid your guilt. Because it's betrayed. It's explained so clearly. What is he saying? It will be stained with the blood of gurus and elders. My enjoyment is at their expense. If only I can enjoy, minus the, minus if someone can come and give you a method, a technique by which you can enjoy and not feel guilty. The only way that you can enjoy something and not feel guilty is by what? Is by telling yourself that what you are doing is right. That's where the person will be doing some atrocious act. Others around will say, why are you doing this? Don't do this. That person says, I am not feeling any remorse. I am not feeling any guilt. Why are you bothered? What makes that person to do that? He has kind of convinced himself, what? This is the right thing to do. To follow your passions is the right thing, no sir. You should do what you are passionate about, no? If someone comes and asks you, what will you say? What will be your answer? Yes, follow your passion. Within brackets, get? Within brackets, what is implied in that advice? Within brackets, get? Get destroyed, huh? True. Because you have to follow your like, and the only way that you can convince yourself is by calling it as? By calling it as? Right. Calling a dog mad and killing it. If you have told yourself that this dog is mad, it's right for you to? The question is, who's to decide whether the dog is? Of course, I am the? Enjoyments will be marked by guilty conscience. And this guilty conscience creates a fear. And this guilty conscience is creating a fear. And Arjuna is confused. On the one hand, he says, should not kill them. On the other hand, he is saying, my enjoyments will be marked. Look at the contradictions. On the one hand, when he talks about the highest renunciation, on the other hand, he is talking about enjoyments getting stained. The man of renunciation will not worry about enjoyments getting stained. A person who doesn't worry about stained enjoyment alone matters, will not talk about better to live on alms. But here you see Arjuna clearly talking two things which doesn't match, which doesn't go together. Betrays what? His periphery is talking something, the core is something else. The periphery is saying something, the core is saying something, and he is torn between, not knowing what direction to take. Yes. Guilt. Guilt arises when you have a set of conditioning. When there is a set of conditioning, and anything you do against that conditioning, or you see anyone doing something against that set pattern of conditioning, and you are helpless about doing that, you feel guilt. Again I repeat, you have a conditioning, and then you do something which you are helpless about. You helplessly do something against your own conditioning, the result is guilt. Again I repeat, you follow the definition? Every human being has a set pattern of conditioning, and I am helpless in times in, there are situations in life, there are times in life where I am not able to stick to my own conditionings. I am helpless about what? I am helpless about what? About doing something which is against it. So this contradiction, I have one ideal image and I see myself somewhere here, this contrast creates guilt. This is the definition of guilt. What causes guilt? I have one superhuman image. Superhuman ku mele adu enna adu, what is that word? Suprahuman, some image I have, some person I have, and I am helpless in order, I am helpless because I am not able to I am not able to stick to that. And I do actions which make me helpless about sticking to that. And those actions I do are in contradiction to that. It is this contrast, it is this contradiction, it is this conflict that creates guilt. Number one. Number two, guilt is that which makes a person go insane. The starting point of insanity, the starting point of schizophrenia, whatever these mental diseases are, the starting point of it is guilt. The starting point of it is guilt. All mental diseases, the starting point of it is guilt. Why? Because you are whipping yourself. And when you whip yourself, this self-whipping looks very holy in the beginning, looks very spiritual in the beginning. See, one thing is, I can whip you. I look like a very bad person. If I sit here whipping myself, you feel, actually I myself will start feeling what? What a good thing. The starting point of diseases, the mental illnesses is this guilt. That's where all spiritual masters, first thing they do is remove the guilt, because the starting point of the disease is the guilt. How it creates the conflict is, one part in you desperately wants it, another part in you says it's the worst thing to do. Why I call it as conditioning is because fundamentally mind is that which divides. Mind divides. What is the division? Right, wrong, good, bad, holy, unholy. It has to divide. It has to say the right hand is holy, left hand is unholy. If the left hand is unholy, chop it off. No. Why? Why keep it? So you will be living with something what you call as unholy. Yeah. Musical instrument. Veena is very holy. Guitar is unholy. When my daughter wanted to play guitar, everyone in the family said, how can she play guitar? Because Veena is Correct. Violin is manageable, tolerable, because nowadays violin is also used. But guitar is, mind is that which divides, and if that idea is planted in her so deeply, what, to play guitar is wrong. So whenever she touches the guitar, whenever she plays the guitar, she will in the deepest core there will be a sense of guilt. Because guilt is, psychologically I am explaining, guilt is the product of division. Guilt is the product of division. And mind is that which divides. And intelligence supports the division. Again I repeat, psychologically, carefully follow. Mind is that which divides, and your intelligence always supports the division. That's where you find all the worldly wisdom, all the worldly logic, all your assessment comes to some kind of a conclusion, either for it or against it. It has to necessarily end up in a division. You cannot say, the mind cannot say, what? Mind cannot say. What it cannot say? The mind cannot experience a compassion. Why it cannot experience a compassion? Why it cannot experience a compassion? Because division. Division makes me blind. Division makes me rigid. Division cannot make me experience love and compassion. So when I see myself doing something bad, or when I see someone doing something bad, first thing that should come is the helplessness. First thing that comes is what today? I don't understand that person is doing it out of helplessness. First thing that comes is what? First thing I plant is what? Bitterness, hatred. First thing that arises is bitterness. First thing that arises is hatred. Why? Because this is something wrong, this is something bad, and the person ought not to do it. Division. Greater the division, greater the greater the guilt. Correct. Greater the guilt. Greater the guilt. Greater the guilt. What happens? More schizophrenic you become. Because on the one hand, you are so much in need of it. On the other hand, it says in you. It says it is, it's wrong. When you say it is wrong, that saying something wrong has not arisen out of an understanding. That's why I started by saying it as conditioning. That calling something wrong bad doesn't arise out of conditioning. Doesn't arise out of an understanding. It arises out of conditioning. It arises out of conditioning. And what is conditioning? What is conditioning? What is the definition of conditioning? That which you have taken it for granted even before you inquired about it. That is conditioning. That's why he says the human being today takes everything for granted. What is conditioning? Conditioning is nothing but taking it for granted even before a process of inquiry happens. After the process of inquiry, study, reflection, understanding, it's not a conditioning, it turns into a conviction. If it is gone through the process of study, reflection, understanding, it turns into a conviction. a person of conviction will not feel guilt about himself, or he will not have hatred towards others. Why? Because he understands to develop this conviction is no joke. Hard work is involved in this. Tapas is involved in this. It's no joke. Hard work is involved. Tapas is involved. And the person has not done tapas. You understand what? Therefore, in relation to others, there will not be hatred. In relation to you, you have a right understanding. Exactly opposite of that is conditioning. What is conditioning? Conditioning is that which is taken for granted, which is accepted as a fact even before inquiry is done. Therefore, conclusions are drawn first, and when conclusions are drawn first and whatever logic comes after that, it's only it's only poems, Select English Poems book. Conclusions are come first, conclusions are drawn first, and then reasoning starts. Select English Poems, poem, Ganesh. No poem. Pawn. That's all it is. Taken it for granted. Creates guilt because conclusions are drawn first. On what basis conclusions are drawn first? Continuously I am fed from outside, and I also repeat it. I can't say it is fed from outside and shift the blame to others. I am conditioned like this, sir. That's why. You can't shift the entire responsibility outside. Even though you have been bombarded, you also party to it, party illa. There is one word, English word, P. You are so, you are so passive. You are so passive that you just swallowed it, accepted it. Now you bring all the logic and reason. You build the edifice of logic and reason on something that you have no understanding about. That's where, take the simple example. Everyone says stealing is bad, wrong. You don't need Krishna to come and say, don't steal, be good, be kind, be sacrificial. Elementary school teacher should teach, not the magnitude of a personality like Krishna. And straight away everyone agrees that stealing is bad, stealing is wrong. One man had this courage to question, why should I not steal? One man had the courage to question, why should I not steal? And came to the conclusion that I will not steal. See, Vivekananda, when he was Narendra, he went to Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. He wanted to learn, he wanted to study. And he had some loans to repay. And poor thing, it was not his loans. It's not that he took the loan. The loans taken by the family. Ramakrishna said, first settle those loans and come. Don't come now. And he was trying to settle the loans. He couldn't. And he was so deeply interested in... See, you can't find a person who is so deeply interested in studying, like genuine, wanting to such person, Ramakrishna said, first to settle the loans and come. So he started thinking, why should I not steal to settle my loans? Why should I not steal? And you should read the discourse. He said, all this is what I thought. Maybe I am not stealing because Ramakrishna will reject me if I steal and repay the loan. It means if he is in agreement with it, I will steal. Are you able to follow his reasoning? At least story madri follow the reasoning. It will be, at least story madri listen to it. Supposing Ramakrishna says, steal and come, burgle the, you know, in that remote corner one ATM is there where no camera and all is fixed. Simply go, break it, settle the loan and come back. Na, he would have done it. In 91, when I met Swamiji to join the course, year 1991, he said, will your parents agree? I said, no, they will not. They will not agree. What have you decided? I said, I have decided to study. 3 months time. Try and convince them. If you can't convince, simply take the train and come. I'll take care. And it's a fact that till today he is taking care. And he is taking care in such a great way, you have no clue to. Either I'll take care. Said, okay. How will you come if your parents don't agree? Said, I'll take the train. And because he only said, take the train and come, no? So I repeated it. I'll take the train and come. Again, how will you come? Said, why is he asking the same? Again, said, see, you said that your parents will not agree and you have no money. How will you buy the ticket? And he gave me 150 rupees. He said, keep it. In case if your father doesn't buy the ticket, and the ticket wasn't 150, it was somewhere around 110 or something. Appo, it was only 110 rupees to Lonavala. Either 110 rupees, 40 rupees extra for train food. He said, 40 rupees extra for train food. In case if your father buys the ticket, return that money back. Return that money back. I have laminated that 150 and I am still keeping it with me. I didn't give it back, even though my father, but he sold out in there. Don't go and tell him that he still has that 150 rupees. I still, he said, how will you come? I don't want you to steal money and buy the ticket and come. You understand? Supposing if he had said, it's okay, if your father doesn't give, simply steal and come. I will not feel guilty at all. 3 months I will not feel guilty. 4th month, first thing that I don't like in that place, carefully follow. I sat and thought all this. First thing that I don't like in that place, I start feeling I done a mistake. Maybe I did the mistake. What is the mistake? Because as it is, my mind is rebelling that I should not have what? As it is, my mind is rebelling what? I should not have? I should not have joined the course. As it is, my mind is rebelling. It's not that. As it is, the mind is rebelling. And for that conclusion that I have to come to, I need supporting factors. What are the supporting factors? First thing. Yeah. To join this course, I stole. What I'll do? Or what I would have done? What I would have done? Two things. What are the two things I would have done? Conclusion, at least Siddharth you can say. Two things I would have done. What? Pack up and go home. Two things I would have done. What? Correct. First thing. Blame the higher. First thing. Blame the higher. Second thing is self-whipping. What is that self-whipping? I did something wrong. Guilt. You follow what I am saying? This is how guilt arises. Out of guilt, you end up self-whipping. If you whip outside, somebody outside, you look very, very bad. And if you whip yourself, you will appear very spiritual also. You will appear very holy. If I cause pain to you, I am very unholy. If I cause pain to myself, I am very holy. If I make you to walk slippers made of thorns, nails in a, I am torturing you, correct? If I make you, carefully follow, if I bring a pair of shoes full of nails and I ask, who will volunteer to walk on this? Others will say, it's called, what is it called? Torture. If I walk, everyone will fall at my feet. Because, are you able to understand the difference? If it is a torture to you, it is a torture to? If it is a torture to your body, it's a torture to? To my body also. But then, if I do that, you will also fall at my feet and say, What a holy Atma, sir. What a holy man you are. Because you are, you understand? Guilt arises when you are divided inside. Guilt arises when you are divided inside. Divided inside into right and wrong, good and bad. Guilt arises. And one thing that is detrimental to a human being is guilt. It's guilt. Eats him up from inside, and he will not be able to do. Will not be able to do anything after that. Therefore, under any circumstances, guilt is not something that you should experience. All morality is based on guilt. From another angle, all morals and ethics, the fundamental is guilt. And it's a vested interest, it's a hidden interest, because if I make you feel guilty, I have made you my slave for the rest of my life, because I become your savior after that. You have no choice but to. So first thing the unwise does is make the other feel guilty so much. Supposing, understand it like that, if someone makes you feel guilty, if you are wise, you will run away from that person. Because it's a slavery. Are you able to follow what I am saying? Supposing if I have proven to you that what you have done is wrong, guilt, I become your, and you have no choice but to be my slave for the rest of your life. It's a very good business. It's a very good. A wise one says what? You are doing it out of your indulgence nature. Understand the nature of indulgence, but don't feel guilty. It's not that he is in agreement with you. It's not that he is saying go and do what you like. In fact, he understands the danger more than you. But first thing he does is not make you feel guilty. Today, all the moral and ethical systems, all relationships, every interaction is based on what? Based on guilt. First plant guilt. First create guilt. How do you plant guilt? How do you create guilt? How do you plant guilt? How do you create guilt? How do you plant guilt? How do you create guilt? Say you are inefficient. You know how we plant guilt? How we allow another to plant guilt in me? How I plant guilt in another? How? By conditioning you to right and wrong. Yes. Adu okay. If you are confused in you are perfectly on the right track now. இந்த க்வெஸ்சனுக்கு ஆன்சர் பண்ணிட்டு அதுக்கு வரானே. ஐ எம் நாட் சேயிங் லா ஆஃப் கர்மா இஸ் கண்டிஷனிங். த வே யூ ஹேவ் அண்டர்ஸ்டுட் லா ஆஃப் கர்மா இஸ் கண்டிஷனிங். லா ஆஃப் கர்மா இஸ் நாட் கண்டிஷனிங். த வே இன் விச் யூ ஹேவ் நாட் யூ இன்க்ளூடிங் யூ வித் இன் பிராக்கெட் இன்க்ளூடிங் ஆக்சுவலி வாட் இட் இஸ் either wrong, the wrong understanding. What is that wrong understanding? How is guilt created? Guilt is created when I constantly tell the other what? I constantly prove to the other. I constantly tell the other. I constantly keep the other's in one, what? Fear. I am the giver, you are the receiver. I am the giver and you are the receiver. How much I have done for you? How much I have sacrificed for you? How much I have risked my life for you in return? Is this what you do to me? You start? You know, like the smile, you know? Oh, it starts flowing non-stop, and that's it. For the rest of your lifetime, you feel? It's not that gratitude comes. Please understand. Gratitude doesn't come. What comes? Slavery starts. You become the slave. How? Because I have established, I have proven what? I am the giver and you are the receiver. As a receiver, what is your duty? What are you supposed to do? Be my slave. Correct. Be my slave. that being my slave is what is understood as love. You be my slave. I have done to you so much. As a father and mother, how much we have done to you for that rest of your lifetime. You must be my slave. If they say, clear, buy na, I tell them what? You are ungrateful. 20 years later, they themselves actually start experiencing what? I was ungrateful. You understand how guilt starts? Division. First reason for division, first reason for guilt is division. The second reason for guilt is that slavery. Last, you start hating that person to whom you have become slave. Love will not come, service will not come, sacrifice will not come, gratitude will not come. What will come? Hatred will come. That's where at some point of time you just want to settle your accounts and get away. At some point of time you want to settle your accounts and say, sir, for what they have done, I have done more than that. Avanga pannathukku I have done 100 times. You follow what I am saying? At some point of time I want to settle accounts and move out. And when I settle accounts and move out, the argument that I give myself is what? For what they did to me, I did compensation. Much more in this person, in the deepest core, always experiences guilt, and it makes the person mad, split, incapacitated to act. Guilt results in a kind of incapacity to act, because torn apart. What are you torn apart? One part in you says something, another part in you says exactly the opposite, which is entirely different from and understand it. Since you brought in that word, I am explaining that. It's very simple to understand. Completely different from the law of karma. Law of karma says only one thing. Law of karma is very simple. It only says what? All your thoughts and actions has a consequence. Will stop. Law of karma is very simple. It's not complicated at all. The law is very simple. What is the law? It says all your thoughts and action has a consequence. Before you start the action, be aware of the consequence. If you are not aware of the consequence, you cannot escape. That's what law of karma says, which is entirely different from morals and ethics, right and wrong, good and bad. Are you able to follow the difference? Law of karma is very simple. When I say very simple, ukkandu pesuradhukku very simple. In that sense, I am saying simple. All of that. Thought and action has a consequence. Before you execute an action, before you utter a word, be aware that you have to experience the consequence. Number one. Number two, are you aware of the consequence? Which is what Upanishad says, the capacity to see the end in the beginning. That's law of karma. The capacity to see the end in the beginning. What is clarity? He asks. Yama tells Nachiketas. The capacity to see the end in the those who can see it, they didn't formulate, they explain this law. What is the law? The law of karma. And what is law of karma? It's very simple. Thought, word and deed. A human being does three types of action. Thought, word and deed. All these actions has a consequence. Since you are the doer, since you are the karta, the doer has to experience the, has to experience what? The consequences. You can't say, I didn't know. You can't say, I didn't know. Nature says, you are supposed to know. You ought to know. You are supposed to know. Why? Because that's where the capacity to question, the capacity to think is given, so that you can understand the consequence and then start the action. If you understand the consequence and then start the course of action, the entire course of action becomes a play, becomes a script. It's a leela. Because you know the script. Are you able to follow now? Krishna had no problem because he saw the end in the beginning. Therefore, his life is called leela, sport. It's a script. It's written very well. And he just played his role. He just played his role very clearly. No problems he had. Are you able to follow now? Law of karma says action has a consequence. Number two, what are the types of action? Three: thought, word, deed. Mano, vak, kaya. Sanskrit. Mano, vak, kaya. Thought, word, deed. These are the three types of action. Before starting it, before executing it, are you aware of the consequence? First of all, we don't even realize that there is a consequence in the first place. Adala appuram paathukana sir. First let us do it. When it comes, we will see. Because anyway, we can't predict the future, no? You think it as predicting the future. It's not predicting the future. It is understanding what action is having a consequence. And you cannot escape experiencing the consequence. Therefore, first thing is what? Penetrate deeply and see what is going to be the consequence, what is going to be the effect. And if you are still convinced, that's what you should do. That's conviction. You go ahead and do. If you are not convinced, what you should do? Whatsoever the action is, you should drop it. To thine own self be, you should drop it. Where areas of confusion take? Areas of confusion take guidance. When you are taking guidance, be prepared to follow it 100%. Otherwise, if you are not ready 100%, don't take it, because you are wasting your time and time. Because it's true. With all dedication, with all sincerity, they come and take advice and go back and do exactly the opposite. You say, Arevi, why did you do this? What should I do now? What to do now? Experience the consequence. Which is entirely different from the conditioning of morals and ethics. Right and wrong, good and bad. This conditioning of right and wrong, good and bad, morals and ethics is what creates guilt. If you truly understand law of karma, you become free. Because if you want liberation, what you should understand? Law of karma. Because law of karma says there is a consequence. first of all, be aware. When you are aware, the thinking starts. What is the thinking? What is the consequence? Completely two different entities. But then, it looks like law of karma, cause and effect, which is not true. Cause and effect. Cause and effect says, action is followed by a consequence. Since you are the karta, you have to experience it. You cannot escape from it. The time period might differ, change, but you will end up experiencing. That's the story in the Bhagavatam, in the Mahabharata. It comes how the entire Yadava clan got annihilated. It's exactly law of karma. Think that you are safe. Think that you are protected by Krishna himself. The grass under your feet will turn against you, and that will bring your destruction. Is the stern law of karma. And you should go through that cycle. How that? Like this. Durvasa, the sage, came. They dressed up a man like a... You know the story, no? They dressed up the man like the pregnant lady and said, boy or girl, bless him. Bless him and say, boy or girl. Durvasa said, pounding stick. This man will give birth to a pounding stick, and this pounding stick will destroy the entire Yadava clan. Whenever they are in real trouble, they will go to Balarama for advice, not to Krishna. So they went to Balarama. What do we do? He said, very simple, burn. And the story is, he gave birth to the pounding stick. The story is, he said, burn it and take it to the, since they are living in Dwaraka, see, take it to the ocean and resolve it. Problem is solved, no? One day, Krishna said to Balarama, tomorrow morning we are going for a beach party. Tomorrow morning is the beach party, he decided. Balarama said, I can't handle all this. He went and drowned himself. That's why Balarama died first. He went and drowned himself in the same ocean, walking on the same grass. Incredible is that story. How they link it. He took all the Yadavas to the beach, and they were given somras. I don't know, maybe imported. Everyone got drunk. When you are drunk, what will you do? When you are intoxicated, what will you do? When you are intoxicated, you will get into a quarrel. All quarrels is a result of some kind of intoxication. When you are not intoxicated, you can never get into a quarrel with another. So any quarrel is out of, and these fellows got intoxicated, they got into a quarrel. So in anger, one person slapped. There was a blade of grass sticking to his hand. So when he hit, that grass turned into the pounding stick. How did the grass turn into the pounding stick? 36 years back, when they immersed the ashes, a few didn't get dissolved. It washed ashore, and it became the fertilizer for the grass, and the grass is waiting for them to come, and they came, and they started hitting each other, killing each other, destroying each other. When they started fighting, Krishna took a few steps back, ready with his bow and arrow. That's the first time you will see Krishna with bow and arrow. Ready with bow and arrow. Why? If anyone escapes, he is ready to shoot them down. The ultimate law will not allow you to, how much ever you try to escape, the ultimate law, Krishna is standing there with bow and arrow, ready to shoot you down. But no one gave Krishna that. No one gave Krishna that struggle, because they killed each other. Krishna being a Yadava, he also has to die by the same curse. What happened? A little bit of metal that didn't get burnt, the fish, and the fisherman, it was caught in the net and it was brought, and the smith, arrowsmith, that lady went and bought that fish, and when she cut that fish, she found the metal piece, saying that it's a very good metal piece. He gave it to the arrow maker. Using that metal piece, he made the tip of the arrow, and the hunter bought that arrow. Using that arrow, he shot Krishna, and Krishna also died. What an insignificant death. Correct, no? Such a great man, how he died so? What an insignificant death. Tired, he is lying. From a distance, the man thought it's the animal's feet, and he shot and he law of this is law of karma. What? You have to experience the consequence. You have a choice before you start the action. Don't ask what sin Krishna did for him to die like that. I know. Don't ask what sin Krishna did. Story is avalodhan. He didn't do any sin. He also has to die, no. Because his body has to die. He need a reason to die. Otherwise you can't live. Imagine Krishna walking around now. He won't be that 16-year-old Krishna, no. He will be. Yeah, he also has to. Body also has to drop. And for the body to drop, it needs a reason. Heart attack is the reason. Coma is the reason. Somebody shooting you becomes the reason. But he also has to. Exactly, the full circle. And then he says, the stern law of karma. What is that stern law of karma? What is that stern law of karma? You have to experience the consequence, and you cannot escape. You cannot escape. If at all you want to escape, there is only one way to escape. What is that way? There is only one way. What is that only way? Take responsibility. The only way is take responsibility. The moment you take responsibility, you become aware, you become conscious, you become alert. That alertness, that conscious, that being aware, that being conscious will save. The same law that explains how fall happens is the same law that explains how you can become. See, also you did it because you are not aware of it. You are being very rash, irresponsible. Now you become responsible. Knowledge brings you this. Knowledge makes you responsible. What is the responsibility? Every thought that I entertain, every action that I do, every word that I utter goes one full round and comes back. Like that Australian thing, no? You fling, what is it? Boomerang. Looks like it's going away, 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 away from you. But then at one point it takes a U-turn, and comes at a great speed to hit you. Like they say in English, you will be hit and you will not know what hit you. You will be hit so hard and you won't know what hit you. What is the way out? Become responsible. Sariya? Inga vandu pesu.
Yes. If the guilt is not there,
correct.
World will be